Good morning, everyone. I, Dr. Sarika Chauhan, Branch Counselor, IEEE VSIT Student Branch, welcome you all to MindQuest, the Quarantine Special Webinar Series by IEEE VSIT Student Branch. I hope everyone is well. Before we begin, I would like to add a gentle reminder for all the participants to keep their mic on mute and switch off your videos throughout the webinar. Ensure they have entered the webinar with their full name and use the chat box to ask questions, if any. We will be sharing the feedback form link in the chat box towards the end of the webinar. Kindly ensure you submit your feedback before you leave the webinar. Today, I would like to start by taking this opportunity to extend my thanks to the principal of VSIT, Dr. Rohini Kelkar, vice principal of VSIT, Mr. Asif Rampurawala, and the management of VDT for always supporting us in these endeavors and providing us with amenities to make them a success. I would also like to thank IEEE Bombay section and all its speakers for joining us in this event and their truly invaluable contribution to it. Now, with much honor, I would like to request our dear principal, ma'am, Dr. Rohini Kelkar, to say a few words. Ma'am?
Yeah, good morning. Good morning, everyone. I'm very happy to welcome Dr. Saurabh, our own Dr. Saurabh, for this today's talk. As Dr. Sarika said, yes, we have been able to do a lot of activities through the VSIT student branch of IEEE. And I'm very happy to have a great response of all of you who have registered for this program. I am getting the reviews of this earlier sessions, and earlier sessions are going on very well. So I'm sure today Dr. Saurabh's session also will fall in the same category. Welcome, Dr. Saurabh. And I'm sure next 1 hour, we all are going to have a great experience. Thank you, Sarika.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a wonderful speech. We shall now begin with today's webinar on experience with IoT, which will be delivered by Dr. Saurabh Mehta, the Chief Academic Officer at VIT and TPEC Chair, IEEE Bombay Section. He has more than 16 years of professional research and teaching experience in wireless system development. In the academic environment, he works on integrating academic and industry collaborations. His research interests are in the area of wireless networks, RFID, IoT, IoE, game theory, and educational technology. He is also an independent consultant in the area of embedded system, wireless technology, education, and technical market research. He has been a technical consultant at companies in India and abroad. He has also been the R&D director of Global Power Resource Private Limited and a research associate at Wireless Communications Research Lab, Inha University, South Korea, and the Computer Science Department of University of Lugano, Switzerland. So we are glad to have you here for today's webinar. Now I kindly request sir to take the session forward. Sir, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. So first of all, thank you very much, Rohini ma'am, for coming to this particular session and giving your valuable guidance to all of us. And Sarika madam and then her entire team with the students and some colleagues, it is fantastic job that you guys are doing. And because of your efforts, we are able to conduct such kind of like a very good webinar series. So without any further delay, I would like to start with like my talk. Basically, maybe before I start, just wanted to give some kind of like a background about me. I have been working in wireless network from almost I can say 2002 onwards on various projects and this thing. And my core competency is into designing like a wireless sensor network thing, and especially designing a protocol stack, conducting wireless network for wireless network performance analysis and designing mathematical modeling for that, and similar kind of like, and also in an embedded system. So throughout my career, I have worked on various this kind of like a project. So today in this talk, I wanted to share some of my experience with all of you. So starting with this thing, I also would like to introduce like my institute. So actually VSIT and we are within a same particular like a campus. So in Vidyalankar Institute of Technology, we are basically running engineering program. And we have 5 engineering branch with us, information technology, computer engineering, electronics and telecommunication, electronics engineering, biomedical engineering. And we also run 2 years postgraduate program in management. So overall, we have more than 3000 plus students as our like a strength. And then we are running UG, PG and PhD programs. And we have very beautiful 11 acre campus. So I invite all of you to visit our campus one day, or as we are organizing many competitions, so I'm sure that through this competition and this thing, you are most welcome to our campus. Now, starting with my presentation, so basically I have divided into 2 parts. Part number 1 is like we will just go through some of the IoT basics, some basic fundamental understanding. And in the second part, I will start with my own experiences. Right? So starting with the first thing, IoT, so you can see that thing in real world, there are lots of information. It's all entire surrounding and everything is like, you know, filled with the information. Somehow we need to get this information and utilize this information for our own, I can say, benefit. To give you an example, let's say that I wanted to do the automation of my office, or maybe I wanted to do the automation of my home, where I'm constantly monitoring various parameter like a temperature, humidity, and based on those parameter, I'm going to control the temperature within my office and within my home, right? Let's say you set the temperature is that, okay, within like a 24 to 24 degree Celsius is like our working temperature. Now once you set that thing, so what is going to happen is that all the sensors, they are going to, you know, keep monitoring what is outside temperature, what is inside temperature, is there any kind of like a difference between these two. If it is there, then switch on the AC. If it is like a too low, then switch off the AC. So with this kind of like a automation, you can save energy and you can work at a very optimized efficiency. So that is our main goal. And any system, whatever we are going to build, is just basically try to optimize the performance. Now, similar to that, in real world, there are many this kind of like a information is there. Just for example, traffic information, maybe you can say working information related to environment, humidity or pollution, and all these things are already there. Now, somehow, we need to convert this information into some useful information, and based on that useful information, we can do some kind of like a action. Now, using those kind of like a information, we can go to the ubiquitous era. Now, what is ubiquitous era? Let me give you one example. You may find that this is like a science fiction, but it is not science fiction. It is already started to come into practice. Now, let's say in the morning when you are waking up, and immediately you close your alarm, the alarm clock is passing this particular message to your washroom and setting all your geyser setting that, okay, now be ready with this particular like a temperature, be ready with like a water outlet, so that I once I enter into the washroom, I don't need to like worry about all those things, and entire thing can be handled appropriately. Now, as I'm moving out of my home, immediately I get a notification that the whatever the road that you are going to take today to reach to your office, do not take this because it is like, you know, full of traffic, better you take the alternative route. So now, you know, at every step you see that I'm getting the information, and this information is making my life easy. So this is what I say, that this is a real information, and it is so important to gather this kind of information. So that information could be related to like the safety, this is related to your health, this is related to like, you know, the environmental parameters, or you can say the different like a physical like a quantity like a temperature or a humidity or something that you can measure. So now when we want to collect all this information, obviously we require some kind of like a sensor. Now coming to the sensor part, now we can see that the sensor has become like a part of our life. I am sure that every one of you are using one or even more than one sensor in your life. Just to give you an example, right now everyone is like wearing a wristband, health band, right? Or a Fitbit or maybe any other company. So what is that? That is nothing but a collection of like a sensor embedded system, which is monitoring your steps, which is monitoring your sleeping pattern, which is monitoring, you know, how many calorie that you have burnt. So they are gathering those kind of like information. And if you are like a running enthusiastic, maybe you are putting some kind of sensor in your shoes also, so that it is looking at your like a running pattern and all this thing. Then CCTV camera, maybe our mobile phone, then RFID card. So these are sensors that we are using in our day-to-day life. So nowadays sensors are actually become like a ubiquitous in our life. I am sure every one of us are using, even if you are traveling through some kind of like a metro train, you are using a smart card. So that is also a sensor, even though it is a passive, but it is a sensor. So this sensor has become like a part of our life. Now this sensor are smart sensors. Some of the sensors have a capability to speak with each other, and then they can pass on this kind of like information. Now to highlight this point, let me just give you one example. Now we all have home appliances at our home, and most of the home appliances, just for example, like a TV, refrigerator, air condition, mixer or washing machine, all those home appliances are smart device. Why it is smart device? Because this device are embedded with sensors, so they can actually send some environmental parameters, and based on that they change their some kind of condition. To give you an example, let's say the TV. Now all the TV nowadays are actually come with some kind of like a light sensor. So always it is keep I guess there was some glitch, but yeah. So you can see that thing, this particular like in a TV, it is embedded with a light sensor. So it can sense what is your background light. And as per the background light, it changes the contrast of a TV picture so that it will not give any kind of like a strain on your eyes. So this is how smart devices are working. Now problem with the smart devices are there that this device cannot speak to each other. Now when they cannot speak to each other, even though they are smart, but they are dumb. So what we try to achieve with IoT or wireless sensor network is that we wanted to give each and every sensor some kind of like a talking ability, so that they can start communicating with each other, so they can share information with each other. And because of this collective information, our entire network becomes intelligent network, or I can say the network which is producing some kind of intelligence which we can use to do some kind of automation in our day-to-day life, right? Now again, I'll go back to my previous example where I say that thing, that as you are walking up, your alarm is giving the signal to your geyser to be ready with a certain temperature water outlet. Now here you can see this thing, the alarm clock is able to speak to the geyser. So that is what I mean by intelligent network. They have the capability to talk to each other. Now once they start talking to each other, you know, they can immediately pass on that, okay, my applicant has been woke up, now he is going to come to like a washroom, so be ready with your system, be ready with a particular like a temperature water, so that he doesn't need to wait for any more time, right? So that's how its entire system works, and this has become in a practice. Now let me tell you another example. Now whenever we are starting our journey, what the first thing we all are doing, first we are checking on a Google map that okay, all traffic is like what is the traffic condition, is there like a more traffic, so we are trying to find, you know, some kind of like a alternate route for that. And when we are traveling by train, immediately we check on some kind of like a real-time application that trains are running on time or not. If it is like delay, then we can take even a different kind of like a measure on that thing. So right now this kind of things are happening, only thing is that the seamless integration is missing. So what we want to do is that we wanted to create this seamless experience, seamless kind of like an integration, and for that IoT is the key technology. Now before the IoT there was another kind of like a technology which is known as a wireless sensor network technology. So in wireless sensor network technology is nothing but a data acquisition system. Now data acquisition system is not a new thing, it is like there from very long time. Even I can say from early like the 70s, 80s when the electronics started growing. So people start developing this particular system where collecting different kind of information and then you can process this information. So sensor network do the same thing. So what they do, they collect the information. Using this information, we can take appropriate action. Now IoT can go one step further to that. In IoT, it is not just collecting the information, but it is actually interacting with some kind of like a human interaction or maybe with another system. So that capability comes from internet. So here in this diagram, you can see that thing, people can connect to the things. Or if let me show you another diagram where things can be connected to the things, right? Let's say one motor car is communicating with another motor car. So this is possible only when there is a proper kind of like a communication channel establishment or that kind of like a network is establishment. So that is what exactly IoT is doing. So in IoT, basically we try to connect all those embedded system directly with internet or maybe in a subdomain with a particular like a internet, right? So that you can connect with each and every individual like a system, or you can interact with human and a machine or a machine to machine in a seamless manner, right? So that's a very basic thing about IoT. Now as here you can see, this is a very basic architecture for wireless sensor network. So here you can see there are like a multiple nodes are there. They are collecting this information that goes to like a sync node, then it goes to the gateway, and from the gateway it is connected to internet. So this is how basically wireless sensor network works. But in IoT, you doesn't require any kind of like a sync node or a gateway. Obviously depends on the application, depends on the scenario where you wanted to use it, but in majority of the case you don't want to use as a sync node or as a collective. Each and every node, it is directly connected to internet, and that is why the name comes as a internet of thing. And nowadays there is one more term which is becoming like a very popular, it is IoE, internet of everything. Means each and everything is going to be connected with internet, and then we can start actually interacting with that thing. So that is, I can say, the advancement of IoT. Now so this is a basic diagram, so I am sure that with this particular diagram it is clear what is like a wireless sensor network and what is like a IoT, right? So in IoT or in basically network, what are the things which is continuously like a changing? So I can say that thing, nowadays we are moving towards the ubiquitous era. Ubiquitous era means it is wherever you go, you will always find a network, you will always find a connectivity, and basically I can say that thing, the network is available to you anytime, any place, on anything or any kind of like a devices, right? So then it becomes like a real ubiquitous, and you will be surprised to know that thing, even in Indian Indian telecom policy, we have considered as a very basic right to every human being to get the information. So earlier we used to call it that roti, kapda and makan, these are the basic three things, but now I can say that thing, roti, kapda, makan and the network, these are the four basic fundamental things that each and every person in this country should be able to get, right? So in then, as I said, machine to machine communication, IoT, so there are number of like devices which can be connected, and each and every one we are going to I can use multiple like devices. So I'll come to that point later on. And as internet technology is like enhancing, we are getting more speed, we are getting broadband, and soon with the Jio fiber technology, we are going to get a tremendous kind of like a speed, that is a minimum 1 Gbps of data speed, right? And then we can see that things, smart networks concepts are actually increasing. Data centric, content driven networking issues are more coming up. Then we are also looking at the context aware kind of like a system. So decision can be taken based on the surrounding parameters. So in a future, we can see that thing anytime, basically on any move, outdoor, indoors, night, daytime, any particular time it is there, you should be able to connect to this thing. Even if you are like, you know, indoor, outdoor, even in a dense jungle, or maybe I can say in underground, you should be able to connect to the things. And then as you can see, there are various kind of like thing to thing connection, human to thing, human to human connection, or between the machine to machine connection, any kind of like a connection should be very well addressed within the IoT. So in this particular diagram is talking about that how basically the birth of IoT started. So this particular like a term comes in somewhere around like 2007 2008, and then people started using this terminology. And this is some a very popular kind of like a graphic by Cisco, and that was actually done in 2011, and they predicted that by 2020 we will have almost 50 billion devices connected to 7 billion or 7 plus billion people. So you can say for each and every person there are more than I can say 7 to 8 devices, and it is almost becoming a true. If you look at the city data, now we all are in a metro city, you can see that thing on an average we are using 3 to 4 different kind of like a IP address, maybe one for your phone, one for your like a laptop, one for your like a desktop computing, or maybe any handheld device, or if you are using any kind of like a any health related system. So then, so we have started using it. Still we have not reached to that particular like a 50 billion limit, but I can say that thing it is almost reaching to that particular like a limit, or we are on the path of reaching to that particular limit. Now just imagine that this many devices are going to be there, and just kind of like a thing that if each and every device is generating even a 1 second data per 1 second, what kind of like a data that we are going to deal with, and what kind of like a, you know, analytics that we have to do to analyze this data and to find out some important pattern out of it. So these are big challenges. Anyway, I'll come to the challenges part later on. So these are the questions that we need to ask. Another very important question is that if there are 50 billion kind of like a devices or even more kind of devices, do we have enough IP address to that thing? And that is one of the reason that we are moving from IP version 4 to IP version 6. As all of you know, in IP version 4, you can support somewhere around 2 raised to 32 kind of like an address. But once you move to IP version 6, you can go for 2 raised to 128 addresses. And even in IP version 8, now people, I mean, scientists have started working on that thing, or even beyond that. So they are talking about 2 raised to 256 or 2 raised to, like, you know, 512. So that kind of like a development is going to happen. And unless and until we don't have that many like addresses, we are not able to accommodate this devices. So even we need to change our existing infrastructure of IT, or you can say internet. Okay, so going further, so there are various kind of like a technology, enabling technology, which is helping us to achieve our dream of ubiquitous computing. And the base of a ubiquitous computing is nothing but an IoT. So what are those technologies? RFID. So nowadays you can see that thing in majority of the colleges, or even in the transport system, or even in the shopping center, people are started using RFID. Then there are using a power sensors. We are using mobile smartphones. There are many kind of like a nanoscience or a miniature sensors available, which we are implementing right from the camera to, you know, pressure sensors and so many different kind of like a sensors, smart objects, machine to machine communication, standardization, new protocols are coming, security issues are coming. We are moving towards the IP version 6 thing, very low power consumption protocol, Zigbee. And very important is that now, as I told you, that many devices will be there, and they are generating so much of data. So this is going to be big data, and we are entering into the big data arena, how we are actually going to tap the potential of that and how we are going to handle those kind of like a data. It's a question. How we are going to store this data, that is another question. So all this comes under like a cloud computing, big data. So these are, I can say, the enabling technology for IoT. Now, here you can see that thing, whenever any particular technology comes, it should be supported by industry, by academia, by manufacturing industry, and also in the consumer market. So this is diagram where it shows that thing, how they are enabling this particular technology. In the R&D section, you can see that there are many companies who are actually working on there. There are many government organizations, just for example, DARPA. There are many universities, University of California, Berkeley, Georgia Tech Institute. So these are some of the leading universities who are into those kind of like a research, and they are actually driving this particular like a technology. Then you see that thing, there are many companies who are making hardware for that thing, making software for them, like a Texas Instrument, then Intel is there, and so many other companies are there who are actually working on that. And finally, who is actually consuming this technology? So already we can see example in a McDonald's, we can see example in a Walmart, Tesco. So these are some of the big retailers company where they are actually consuming this new technology and driving this entire technology. And soon we will see that thing, it is coming down to even a smaller company, right? So this is a very important diagram just to see that how this entire technology has been driven by all three aspects. Okay, so in summary, if I have to say that what is basically the IoT, so I can say that thing, it is a combination of information technology, operational technology, and smart devices like a sensors, embedded system. When we are putting all this thing together, it is working as a IoT network. So that is the very simple definition for IoT. So now what are the challenges that we are going to face in IoT? I mean, some of the challenges already government, or maybe I can say from the industry perspective, they started to address that thing, but still these are open issues. Just to give you an example, here you can see that thing, the security is obviously like a very big issues that we have. And beside the security, there are technical challenges, there are economical market related challenges, means business challenges, there are legal regulatory challenges, there are socio-ethical challenges as well, right? So just to brief you about each and every like important aspect. So at the economic front, you have to develop a technology which is like affordable for small scale industry, big scale industry, so that can adoption of this technology percolate very fast, right? Second thing is about socio-ethical. Now just imagine that you are generating so much of data, everyone is generating that many data, and there are so much of like your private data, your important data, and it will be open to all, which is not right. Now how much data we need to share with the system, how much data we need to put it on a like a cloud, and how much we need to protect. So these are the issues that we need to tackle, and then there should be a proper policy, there should be a proper kind of like a system and some kind of like the steps taken by should be taken by the government to take care about that. And also there are technical challenges. Just for example, I mentioned to you about the architecture challenge, then standardization challenge, then optimization of different protocol, address issues. So all those technical issues are also there, where each and every engineer researchers are working on that thing. And then there is also legal and regulatory aspect to that, that if we are coming up with this particular technology, what are the government rules and regulation? So we need to follow the government rules and regulation. Otherwise, you know, everyone can start taking the advantage of the data they can use in any way. Sometimes it may be a very harmful, and it could harmful to at an individual level as well, right? So these are, I think, very important issues that is related to IoT. So again, briefly, you can see that thing, we need something related to architecture, governance, service openness, interoperability, connection of real and virtual world, then what kind of like a spectrum we need to give it to like a IoT. So do we need to come up with a specialized like a band for it, or whether whatever the band right now we have, is it sufficient for it? So again, there are many questions from the RF front. Then standards. So these are, I can say, key issues open in IoT technology. So in case some of you would like to carry on your research, you can look at those particular like problems. Okay. So now we are entering into the second part of like my presentation, where I wanted to share some of my experience with you and what kind of like a work I have done in this particular like a domain. So starting with this particular like a session. So first I wanted to show you about like one project that we have done in collaboration with IIT Bombay. So I'm thankful to my ME students who actually helped me to develop this kind of like a node. So our challenge was to develop some hardware which is cost effective. That is the first requirement. Second was there are many actually hardware were available in the market, but here you can see that thing, some of these commercial modes, they do not have some kind of like a features which we would like to have in our system. So that is what like we wanted to enter. Especially we wanted to do some kind of like a multiple radio chip so that our node can work on a different frequency band. We wanted to come up with a directional antenna, some kind of like a different antenna, so that single antenna can work on different frequency. And then we also wanted to come up with ongoing online, or you can say on air programming features. So nowadays in a commercial mode, these features are there, but at that time it was not there. So we proposed that thing and we started to work on that thing. So our basic project was there that we wanted to sense some of the pollutant or hazardous gas in air quality, and this information should be passed on to the municipality, or even it should be put it in some kind of like a sewage pipeline. So whenever there is some kind of like a leakage, immediately alert goes to authority and they can take a proper action to that thing, right? So that was like a basic design of our like a mode. So this is the diagram of like our design node. So basic design was done by some IIT student, but we have improved a lot in this particular design. And you can see in this particular node, it is based on like a stack. So you know, every time if you wanted to change certain module, you can change it. So here you can see that thing, if the you can change it. See here you can see that thing, radio module, you can change it. Then there is a sensor module. So if you wanted to use different sensor, you can also do that thing. So every time you don't need to change this entire basic hardware. In commercial mode, it is coming as a complete embedded system. So you cannot have this kind of like a separate segregation. And also the cost of commercial nodes are, at that time it was somewhere around like 10,000 to 15,000, depends on the radio strength or frequency or what kind of sensor you wanted to take. And we developed this particular node at the cost of 3,000. And even if we go for a mass production, we are sure that we can take this value to a very low value, something somewhere around, you know, 3,000, or 1,000, or even below that thing. And then we created a network of those kind of like a nodes. So this is like a very good example of IoT, or you can say wireless sensor network, where it is going to connect the data, where it is communicating with each other and passing all this particular like a information to base station, right? So this is example one that I wanted to share with all of you. Okay. Now coming to another project that when I started to work in a field, I was working on this particular area for a very long time. We done many improvement in this thing. It is like a battery monitoring system. So what is battery monitoring system? So you can see that thing, there are many data centers, right? So this data centers are actually supported by two kind of like a power. One, it is by battery, and one, it is by the main power supply, or sometimes even backup as a like a generator. So in a data center, to work data center 24/7 is extremely important because data is very precious. Just to give you an example, just take the example of banking system. Now your ATM system, or you can say all your transaction, internet banking, everything work on those data center. Now this in data center, it should be highly reliable. It should never stop working. So generally what is happening is that this data center are supported by series of battery. All batteries are kept over there in a series, and we need to constantly monitor the performance of each and every battery, right? Because these batteries are connected as a like a bank that you can see here in diagram, like this kind of like a bank. And in this bank, what is generally happen, all those batteries are connected in series. So if one particular battery performance goes down, it may happen that entire bank could be the failure. So our requirement was to continuously monitor the I characteristic and V characteristic of those batteries, and based on that thing we have to do certain performance prediction that this particular battery is going to be like a fail, or there is a chance of like a failure, so that it will be notified to engineer and engineer can go and replace that battery or maybe take any kind of like a measure to that thing. So this particular system, in that thing we try to develop some kind of like a monitoring system. Yes, this entire system was a wired one, and we started to work on this system to make it as a wireless thing. We have conducted many kind of like a test on that thing, but it is not yet implemented in the field. But the wire system is working absolutely fine. So there is a notation in everyone's mind that when we are talking about IoT or when we are talking about like a wireless sensor network, it is always like a wireless. It's not necessary. Sometimes even it is with a wire technology, but the basic principle remains the same. Okay. Now there was another system that we have actually done is that thing. And when I was working in this particular like a company, so in field, what we have observed is that generally if you go to like a rural place or maybe to a very remote places, when there is like a telecom tower, or you can say the cell site, so these cell sites are also supported by battery banks. Now generally no one is taking care of this battery banks and all these things. One, it is like installed, it is installed, and then maybe on a frequent visit the service engineer goes there and then check about this thing. Now what we have observed is that at many places, what people are doing is that, you know, because in a rural area or a remote area, people, they are facing some kind of like a electricity problem. So generally what they do, they theft those batteries and they take it away with them. So that what going to happen to our cell site, it is like a down. So we were used to get like a many complaints from a telecom company that our cell site are down and all this thing. And generally when we see that thing, we always found that the batteries are misplaced or battery connection has been removed. So people, they take the battery, then again they put the battery. So all those kind of things were happening. So we put anti-theft battery system over there. So whenever somebody is touching to the battery or moving the place of a battery, immediately the notification comes to us. And then we can notify this to our, I can say, the telecom company with whom generally we have a sales agreement, I mean service agreement, and then the entire record has been kept. So this is basically about the battery monitoring system, and that's how it basically works. So this is a basically a very huge project, and from that huge project we are actually working on a very small part, that is to manage to the battery, developing a software for them, then looking at their particular like, you know, performance and all this thing, right? So this is the industrial application that we have done. Okay, so now another industrial application that I wanted to show you. So in this project, what is this basically inventory control? So there are many kind of like a distributor in India. They generally distribute so many different kind of like a varieties to the retailer, and then from the retailer it goes to the customer. So sometimes what happens at the distribution chain or in entire supply chain management, some things goes missing, whether it is by system missing or by like, you know, the human mistake or maybe like a bad intention, we don't know. But to monitor this supply chain, it is extremely important that at each and every checkpoint there should be a proper inventory control. So how to do that? So for that thing we developed our own system, and in this thing we have started using RFID as a chip. So this basically was working for one company. They are into like a battery business. So in a battery business, each and every battery, they cost very heavily. So let me show you the diagram here. So here you can see, maybe in batteries, this particular battery can cost you somewhere around like, you know, 10,000 to 15,000, depends on its capacity, depends on its making and all that. But on an average, the cost of one battery is 10,000. If someone is taking away this battery, it's like a huge loss to entire company. So what we have done is that you can see that thing. See here on every battery, you can see the white strip. So these are nothing but actually RFID chips. So this RFID chips, we tagged all the batteries with that. So whenever they are moving or whenever they are coming into one particular point, all those things become like, you know, automatic system without even human interfacing or something. It has been controlled easily, and it has been checked, recorded this thing. So no human efforts are, actually required, and entire system is like automated. So there is no chance for any mistake or mishap, and you can have accountability at every point. So that was the main goal of this particular like a system. And there are many systems actually available in the market. Many big companies are there who are making those kind of things. Even for the battery management, yes, there are systems. But generally what happened that those systems comes with lots of parameter. Now when we are working with the Indian company, they generally do not have big budget. So what they require is that they hardly require like, you know, few functions out of that system, and they just wanted to operate with this thing. So as a technical consultant or as a like a engineer, our job is to make that system as a cost effective, make as an indigenous thing, and to bring down those particular costs to a very minimum level so that it can be easily adapted by Indian companies. So it's basically, you can say, kind of like a reverse engineering, or even in the reverse engineering, we come up with our own kind of like a innovation thing. So there are many stories to like our development. Now I just wanted to share you one particular like a important story, and why I wanted to share, because as an engineer, this is very important for all of you. Generally, when you design certain system in an office or in your lab, you are not knowing about the actually filled parameters. So you think that, okay, my design is perfect, it is working very well, and then, you know, you just start developing on that thing. But when you try to implement that in a real field, you will realize that your system is not going to work. Now when we were actually designing this inventory control, so there was some kind of like a team, they we were just noting down all the requirements. So they said that, I asked them that internet will be available. So there was like a marketing team. The marketing team, obviously they don't know anything about the this thing. I think they never even went to the warehouse. So they just simply say that thing, yes sir, you will easily get internet, there is no problem to it, and we are doing great. And based on that thing, we developed our system. Now when we really actually implemented those things, so generally those kind of like a warehouse is out of the city. So you can say it's kind of like a remote area where you have a problem with the electricity, and you also have a problem with the connectivity. So when we identify this problem, immediately we need to make some changes into our system. Lots of like a change happens. So my advice is that whenever you are developing any system or this thing, and generally to all the students, so please do the field study. Even I tell this thing to my undergraduate students, when you are making any kind of like a project, so just don't think it as a like, you know, making some kind of like a protocol or so a prototype. And but you need to go to the field, try to understand the real parameters, real condition, and then try to incorporate into your project, right? So this is just a small story that I wanted to share. So likewise, we learn many experience while developing those kind of like a system. Okay. So now coming to this again, to another like a industrial project. So in this industrial project, it is related to jute mill. So generally what happens in a jute mill, here in diagram you can see that thing, there are number of like a motors available, there are number of like a machineries available, and these machineries are very old, and they keep on a regular interval, they just break down, and because they break down, it effect on like, you know, the production of an entire like a mill. So idea is that we can implement few sensors on some important like a system, and we can keep checking their parameter, and based on that parameter we can predict their kind of like, you know, the breakdown schedule, or we can say the maintenance kind of a thing, so that the mean time failure has been reduced to a minimum and system is always going to be up. So this is also like a very challenging, because even if you have to like, you know, generally I know that students are working on Arduino board or maybe a Raspberry Pi where they have to handle hardly one or two sensors, but just imagine when you have to handle almost like 100 plus sensors or maybe even more than that. So how you are going to get those kind of like a number of channels, how you are going to integrate those channels with your embedded board, what board will be like, you know, best suitable for that. So these are the real learning and real kind of like a challenges in designing a practical system into that one, right? So we are not going into much detail about that thing, but this is one example. So in a predictive maintenance, you have to come up with those kind of like a system so that it can predict when the system is going to fail and how you can recover easily from that failure. Okay, so same thing. So there are like many few photographs. Now coming to another one. So this is kind of like a, I can say, undergraduate project as well as like a ME project. And in that we try to do is like a home automation. So nowadays everyone is aware with Alexa, everyone is aware with the Siri. So these are voice enabled devices. So this is bringing a new dimension into IoT development. So now, you know, you are not just need to give any kind of like a touch based interface, but with a voice thing. So this is going to be a game changing, I can say, the parameter into the home automation. You just need to speak about something and immediately, you know, the based on that thing, home automation should be going to happen. So then what are the things which is required? So voice skill development, there are different kind of like the skills that you have to develop. Then small home applications. So we do some automation of like a light control, fan control, air condition control, or overall like a, you know, you can control your music system, and so many devices you can control with this thing. So still it is like under development thing, and so that's the reason I have not put some kind of like a photographs over here. And so what we are doing is that we try to integrate those kind of like a voice enabled thing into the system, and then based on that we can come up with a home automation system. Okay, then another experience that I wanted to share is related to education. So I feel that IoT is the best way to hone your skill, and through the IoT you can learn so many different subjects. To give you an example, you can learn embedded system, you can learn embedded programming, you can learn about the data analytics, you can learn about the computer science, you can learn about like, you know, big data, then you can learn about like a system integration. So through IoT, if you start taking like very seriously, you can learn many subjects. How generally people, they start working with like, you know, robotics, and through robotics there are lots of learning is happening. So in a similar line, I also thought that we should design some kind of like a curricula, that this with this curricula each and every interested candidate can learn by themselves. So I developed 100 plus hours of self-learning basically course. So in this course, what you can do is that you can learn about like, you know, on different boards, and this is actually divided into different kind of like a difficulty level, easy, moderate, difficult, and based on that you can, you know, enhance your skill. So it is focusing more onto like the sensor integration, how to implement the wireless communication into that thing, or the wired communication into that thing, and integration with the third party software. Let's say you are making some system and you want that kind of like, you know, the notification on your Twitter or maybe your Facebook or maybe your own SMS system or your own application. And let's say taking the government data and writing something on the government data and getting this thing. So that you have to work with a third party software or a system. So that also you can learn by this particular like a course. So later on I am going to share this material, this particular course material with the organizers, and through them I am sure that all of you will get it. or even if you want, you can go to like my website and you can download it from there. So these are some of the things. And now if I say, recently we have also started working on a sports industry, because sports industry in India is increasing by many folds. So as per the new prediction, the sports industry is going to be like, you know, a very big industry, $1 billion industry. And it is the growth rate is somewhere around like, you know, every year it is like a 200 to 200 times of that thing. So what we try to achieve is that we are developing various kind of like a performance enhancement system with IoT. So I'll give you one particular like a project information. So that is related to like a bowler. So generally what happens when you play the cricket, and if you are interested to be a bowler, so you have to practice a lot in net. So generally in a small school or a district level, or you can say the club level, you don't have luxury of having multiple coaches or luxury of like a video taping and analysis of those kind of things. Generally, these facilities are available at the national team, or you can say at our international team. So in that case, when you have multiple players and there is hardly one coach, it is very difficult for the coach to, you know, judge each and everyone performance. So we have developed a system where bowler can actually check his line and length, whether I'm putting on a proper line my bowling, or it is on a, with a proper kind of like a length, and with a proper speed. So speed, but these are the two parameters we are checking, and based on that you generally get the report, and this report you have to show it to like a coach, or coach can get by some kind of application. So he can give you the advice that, okay, you are making this mistake, your stamina is going down, you have to work on this thing. And so this is just one example that I wanted to give you. Then another project that we are working on is that batsman balance, because in cricket, batsman posture and the balance is very important. So when you are like a flicking to a, like, you know, cover drive, or when you are taking a pull shot, so you should follow the perfect follow through. If you don't do that thing, at the long run, it is going to injure yourself. I mean, so that we can see that Sachin Tendulkar was like injured with like a tennis elbow because there was some mistake in his grip and all that thing. So this kind of like the things happen. So we wanted to save those things and enhance the performance of a player. So we are working on those kind of like a project. Then football player, and even in the archery, we can implement this thing. Even if you are doing a, like a regular yoga, so how to monitor those things. So all those projects are related with the sports industry, individual performance enhancement. So there are many projects, and if any of any one of you are like interested to do this kind of like a project, you are more than welcome to collaborate with me. So these are some of the example, and I can say, share my experience with all of you. So these are some of the references. If you are interested, you can go through those references, you can read more about it if there is any query. So now we'll go to like a question and answer session. So thank you very much. Thank you all. So now over to the organizer. Yeah, so over to...
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. Yes, sir. So thank you, sir. It was an indeed informative session. We would now like to present some questions that students have asked. Okay. First question is by Samantha Chinta from Vidyalanka School of Information Technology. The question is, what advice would you give to students planning on working in the in this field of IoT in the future?
Okay, so partially I have already covered this particular like a question in my presentation. So I can say this thing, in case if you would like to work in this particular field, so start developing your skill, and based on your background, let's say I'm assuming that you are from information technology, so basically your background is in computer science, or I can say in a programming. So I can advise you to focus on more on like, you know, if you are interested into a big data analysis, so just go into like a data science like a stream, try to develop your skills in that thing. In case if you are more into application development, so yes, we require lots of engineers who can develop some novelty kind of like an application based on those kind of like a hardware interface. So even you can go for the thing or big data thing, or you can say data storing technology, then configuration of this thing. So these are some of the areas where you can start developing your skills so that it can help you to get employment in this area. Or even if you are interested to be your as an entrepreneur, you can do this thing. Because I know that couple of students, they started their own company, they come up with a very good like a novel idea in using like IoT, and now they are doing good. I hope that I have answered your query.
Yes, sir, very well said. The next question is by Akash Rohila from St. John's College of Engineering and Management. The question is, due to this ongoing lockdown, what is your viewpoint on how we can improve education by implementing IoT?
Okay, so I think I have taken this particular question in detail. So the last experience that I have shown to you, that I feel that thing, lots of students, if they can take it IoT as a like an education subject, so through this subject they can earn, like, you know, learn so many different skills and variety. So that is how you can use this one. And another very good application of IoT in education industry is that you can develop come up with so many different kind of like a system. To just give you one particular like a project that we developed long time back is like a clicker. So that clicker was based on IoT thing. Each and we developed some kind of like a some low cost embedded devices which are wirelessly connected to one central point. And what we can do is that we can ask question to the students on the screen, and student has to answer those using those kind of like a clicker, so that I can do the analysis of each and everyone student's understanding, where they are lacking, what they are doing, and that project was like a good and appreciated, and we need to take it like a further. So one example I can give you is that all of you can see that kind of like a system in Kaun Banega Crorepati, where Amitabh Bachchan is asking for a Janta Ki Rai lifeline, and then everyone start pressing ABC option and this thing. So similar kind of like a system we have even built for our students and the teachers. So from the teacher's perspective, I can get more insight into your understanding of the subject. And from student's point of view, it is more like engaging activity in IoT. So there are two aspects to it. Using IoT, you can take it as a, like a subject, and then you can develop your skills. And these are some of the examples of projects that you can do in education industry.
Okay, sir. So the third question is by Sairaj Rajan Mahadik from Rajiv Gandhi Institute of Technology. He is asking, what are the new updates on most recent developments in IoT technology?
Okay, so I don't have like a particular like a answer to it, because it's like a very brief, because IoT is evolving. There are new steps are coming in. Already I have mentioned that. Now people are not talking about IoT, but now they have started to talk about IoE, Internet of Everything. So they wanted to have those kind of connectivity in this thing. And then basically the advantage of IoE and IoT is that it is a multidisciplinary kind of like a stream. So whatever development is happening in the another area is exactly applicable in IoT also. Let's say you have come up with new kind of like a biotechnology sensors or this thing, immediately you will see that thing after a few months there is a new product which is helping a humankind, and it is accepted in the IoT technology. And if you are talking from the technology perspective, so there are many advancements in the security area, there are many advancements from the protocol area, there are many advancements from the architecture point of view. So all those aspects, there are many advancements, and you can gather lots of information related to that from basically the standards. So if you are interested, maybe you can look at those different kind of like a standard, ZigBee standard, 15.3 standard, 15.6 standard, so that you can come to know what are the new actually development happening from the technical point of view.
Okay, sir. So the next question is from Borude Payal. She is from Amrit Vahini College of Engineering.
Okay.
Her question is like, how can we survey the IoT industry, including our competition and for projects generally?
Okay, so when you have to do some kind of like a survey, so there are some like a good website I can suggest you, or maybe you can just follow certain good companies. So generally I follow the National Instrument, Texas Instrument, Intel. Then there is a very good like a open community, or even if you wanted to follow to like element14.in, so that is like their Indian version. So over there also lots of new information is coming. And beside that, maybe your college might be the member of some society like IEEE. So there is a special kind of like a society for IoT, for a smart city, for a smart transportation. So you try to follow those kind of like a society, and you will regularly going to get updates about this thing. And similar like in IEEE, there are ACM, then there are Computer Society of India. So there are many professional societies, and there are many like a special interest groups who are actually working on this particular like a technology. So simply you start following them and you will get regular updates. So this is the best way to go through the survey work. And many companies, they big companies who are actually into this kind of like a business, they publish their white paper. So study those kind of like a white paper. I'm also going to give one white paper to organizers, so later on the organization can circulate to all of you. So through this white paper, you can come to know that this is how you have to find the details and you can do the survey work.
Sure, sir. Sir, we will take, there are a lot of questions in the chat box. So we will take one last question, which is a really good question by Sheikh M. What is the best way to innovate and make the Internet of Things a reality?
I can say that Internet of Things is not like it is not a reality. It is already a reality. And the innovation that you wanted to come up with is like, you know, there are two ways to it. Number one is that you just simply kind of like a follow the system, what other people are following, and you try to bring your unique point into that one. I give you one example. That battery monitoring system or inventory control system that were already there in the market. It is not like that something new that we are doing. But what we try to do in this thing is that we try to bring innovation in terms of like a bringing down the cost. What we try to do innovation is that it is making suitable for the Indian conditions. So these are the kind of like a small innovation you can bring into your system. It is called as a customization. So basically over there you can bring those kind of like innovation. Okay, another innovation is that maybe you can think about certain kind of like a new application. Now I give you one example is that if you just go into like a industry or in your liking area, definitely you will come across many kind of like a problem. I again share you like a two example. I'm a like a cricket enthusiast. I love to watch cricket, and at some point of my time even I played a club cricket. So when I look at those kind of like cricket and this thing, I found that there are this kind of like a gap. And if we could have received those kind of like a training, we could have been like, you know, national player maybe. Maybe. So that's just a dream or a wish. But so by going into particular like a domain area, you will also come to know about like many challenges, and you can come up with your, you know, new innovation. And another thing, in case let's say you don't have any idea, what I will suggest you is that there are many different competitions are happening across the globe, even in India, by IEEE, by many different society. So keep participating in those kind of like a competition. Even though if you are not able to like, you know, win those things, don't worry about that thing. Just participate on those things. So this competition will give you the idea that what are the challenges right now faced by the companies, faced by the, you know, government, faced by this thing. I mean, recently there were like lots of competition related to COVID-19. So many students and so many like researchers, they come up with a very novel idea in those area that, okay, if we, so by, you know, engaging yourself into those kind of like a competition, you can start like, you know, thinking about innovative process or innovation in incremental way also you can do. And that's the best way to do some innovation.
Okay, sir. So these were the questions. Now, thank you so much, sir, for taking up this question. Now I request Arya to present vote of thanks. Over to Arya. Arya, are you there?
Hello?
Yeah, you can continue. Yeah, you are audible. Continue.
Good afternoon, everyone. I, Arya Samarth, Chairperson, IEEE VSIT Student Branch, would like to thank Dr. Saurabh Mehta for being a part of MindQuench webinar series and explaining the topic so carefully to all the students. I also express my thanks towards our principal, Dr. Kelkar, and Vice Principal, Mr. Rampuravarla, for taking the time out to be the part of today's webinar. The webinar has taken us through various aspects of IoT, introducing us to the depth of the technology. It's one of the most popular technologies of Industry 4.0. Thank you for discussing its many applications with us and touching upon its potential and future implementations. We will certainly benefit from these learnings. Now, for the attendees, you will find a link to the feedback form for this webinar in the chat box. Everyone is kindly requested to fill it up before leaving the webinar. Also, you will receive your e-certificate for participation within 1 week on submission of your feedback. Emails will be sent to registered attendees to fill the feedback form in case you miss the link in the chat box here. Please ensure that you submit the feedback form by today. The email will also give you access to the presentation and the recording of today's webinar, as it will be uploaded on the YouTube channel of IEEE VSIT Student Branch. I would like to thank everyone for their active participation. Thank you, everyone. Stay home, stay safe.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Before leaving again, once again, we'll request all of you to fill up the feedback form. Thank you so much, Saurabh, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for giving me this platform to interact with you all and sharing my experience. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.